ज्योतिर्गमया
ज्योतिर्गमया
मृत्योर्मा
मृत्योर्मा
अमृतं गमया
अमृतं गमया
ओम शांति 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 ही
ओम शांति शांति शांति
दिस इनोकेशन इज अ ब्यूटीफुल प्रेयर We are invoking peace in us. Okay, it's not prayer to some God sitting somewhere. Oh God, give me that, give me this. No. We are invoking peace in us as Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Peace. Now, how can we get peace? How is it possible that somebody can get peace? You can get happiness actually. You can purchase happiness. Right? It is sold in Mayurveda. Drink a cup of this, you'll get happy. Drink a bottle of this, you'll get happy. Happiness is sold in bottles and cans and tins. Okay? Everything is sold. How can somebody sell peace? Peace is not a positive thing. Peace is the absence of everything. Absence of disturbance is called peace. Happiness is also some disturbance. I want this, I'll be happy. So the moment you are prompted to move, you can sell it. But how can you get peace, please tell me? Which is absence of any movement. Okay? So the peace has to be, I have to discover the peace in myself, which means my agitation has to come down. Stress has to come down. How can it happen? The peace can happen only when asato ma sadgamaya. Means, if I find a path of truth, if I find the truth, I'll be peaceful. What is truth, we'll analyze. What is satyam, what is reality, we'll understand. So from untruth, I have to move towards the truth. So that is the requirement. Then I'll find peace. As long as I live in untruth, I'll be in a state of agitation and disturbance. That's the first step. Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya. To achieve that, what will happen? What is need? I need to have the light, means wisdom. The truth cannot be found in street. Truth cannot be found in ashrams. Truth cannot be found in mountains. Truth cannot be found anywhere. It's not a commodity to be found. Truth can be found only within you. In you. As you. So for that you need wisdom. Jnana. So I need tamasoma jyotirgamaya. From darkness to light I have to move. Darkness of ignorance. So darkness of ignorance, if I move, then my agitation comes down, disturbance comes down. Right? Clear? Then what is the effect of that? Mrityorma amritam gamaya. From death to deathlessness I'll go. So now this is not a death after age of 50, 60, 65, no. Every moment we die out of stress. Every moment I die out of fear. Every moment you die out of tension, okay? Moment you have confusion, we die actually. There's a fear generates in us. So if you live in truth, there's a peace in you and you'll become deathless. The peace is deathlessness. The peace is freedom from death. So this invocation is a remembering for yourself that if I have a path of wisdom, if I go from darkness to light, I'll become free from all the stress and live in peace. Three pieces. Adi Bhautika, Adi Daivika, Adhyatmika. I get disturbed in the physical world. I get disturbed by some divine acts. I get disturbed in my mind. So in all these conditions, I need to be peaceful. How I can be? This is the question. This is the real spiritual journey the spiritual journey is how do I find peace, not in mountain, not in ashram, not in the home, but in my heart. That is called real spiritual journey. Okay. So entire spirituality is focused on only one aspect, the finding the peace within. The peace within translates to love outside. Okay? Inner peace translates into the love. Inner peace translates into clarity, wisdom. The peace is the foundation, the love is the radiation, the clarity is the outcome. So that's what is spirituality. And this peace is called God. The peace is called Brahman. So we think of God as some superpower. What more superpower is there than the inner peace? You tell me. The inner power of peace is this tremendous power. So that, seeking that is called spiritual journey. So this is captured beautifully in the prayer. Asato ma sadguru. Any questions? Can I proceed? Yes.
So do you think that by finding inner peace, you will be able to find yourself simultaneously?
Self is peace. Okay, the question is, by finding the peace, can I find self simultaneously? Self is peace. Self is love. Self is wisdom. So finding the peace and finding the self is one and the same. So this is the spiritual journey. Now we have a lot of concepts of spirituality, okay? So the real crux of the spirituality is finding peace within. I am peaceful. I cannot have control over the external situation. Tomorrow there can be disturbance here. Tomorrow there can be calamity there. Okay? In spite of everything, how I can be peaceful? That's where Bhagavad Gita was taught to Arjuna. Yes,
sir.
Yes,
there's some other quote that I read, that peace cannot be an aspiration. It's all ingrained.
No, peace is ingrained,
you
but aspire for peace. Yeah, his question is, peace cannot be aspired, peace is ingrained. Absolutely true. Peace is ingrained, but have you discovered it? Okay?
It's a journey.
See, as long as you have not discovered it, it's an aspiration. Once you've discovered it, it's a wealth. So a person, it's like what is the quotation which somebody has told, okay? I don't know whether he has become peaceful, okay? That's a different matter. So like one of the billionaires in India, I can quote the name, he made a statement in the press. Money is not important in life. Accurate statement, is there wrong in that? He has already billions. For him, money is not important. But somebody is struggling for 100 rupees. 1 rupee is important for him. So, who makes the statement? For whom is who makes the statement? This question. Peace cannot be aspired. Peace need not be aspired. It's within you. It's somebody who is very close to peace. Hey, don't aspire for anything. It's there here only. Somebody is struggling for peace. You say, don't aspire for peace. Then what do I aspire for? should I aspire for disturbance? Understand? See, this way, the spiritual teaching always has a content and the context. And who tells to whom? So if you miss this, then teaching can be taken out of context and make a lot of confusion. For example, Jesus taught, if somebody hits you on one cheek, show me the other cheek. Very good teaching. Teaching is correct. Okay? A person understood it properly. There's a fighting. That fellow hit him in this cheek. Hit here, so now what to do? Third step. So the teaching has to be understood in a proper context. Jesus told if somebody hits you, don't get angry, but handle the situation calm and peace. So hit, showing the cheek was only a
metaphor.
So now you understand wrongly. So that's where the metaphor, the content, the context has to be clear. That's where the importance of a living master comes into picture. Okay? And because living master is required, because time to time the context changes, social context changes. the communication context changes.
If I look at a child, a child when it is a child is very peaceful.
Yes, yes.
And when the child grows, not only child grows into adult, for example, not only because of body, but also because of growth in the mind and other intelligence. But why is it that when mind grows, adult is not able to become peaceful but catch anxiety much more?
I'll tell you. His question is, a child is peaceful, whereas an adult is disturbed. Okay? Why is that so? Child is peaceful because child has no thinking ability developed. Child has feeling, emotion. We have three abilities: feeling, emotion, and thinking. So from childhood, feeling is there, emotion is there, thinking ability grows as you grow. What is the difference between feeling, emotion, and thinking? Is there a difference?
Yes, sir.
What is the difference?
Feeling and emotions are instantaneous.
Feeling and emotions are for a current situation. Thinking is for a future or past.
It's a processing unit.
It's a processing unit. So, feeling and emotion are for this moment. Okay? So, then gradually as the child grows, it develops the ability what to do in future using this situation. You understand? So thinking is the ability to project how to handle this. That's what growth is about. Now that's a normal faculty, it's important faculty. Because tomorrow I have to handle my life, I have to know. Right? So for example, how feeling and emotion developed in a man is, somebody was going in a forest earlier and he found a tiger. And he had to run for life. He cannot think. There is no thinking required. He has to run. Feeling is there, and only emotion called fear rises, and he has to run. Right? It is to this moment. But now gradually as thinking ability developed in a man, okay, tiger came in that place. I should avoid that place. So learning is happened. Thinking is for learning. So then tomorrow I should not go to that place. So that's the right thing to happen. But now thinking started getting misused. Oh, tiger is there. What will happen if my child goes there? That tiger, then fear rises. So what happens is now you are creating scenarios which are non-existent. And the present moment you are feeling stress. So wrong use of thinking faculty creates disturbed peace. The child is peaceful because thinking ability is minimal. What is required for day-to-day survival? Hungry, he will cry. The mother will give something, eat. More. Whereas human being hungry, he will eat go to burger, this food, that food. Some 10 choices come from the past. Okay? So no, that food is not okay. So you have multiple choices are thrown up. Okay? Then, if I eat food today, what will I eat tomorrow? Day after tomorrow? So you start projecting multiple scenarios and your nervous system gets overburdened. And that is called disturbance of peace. So does it mean that we have to stop thinking? No. We have to use the thinking in a right way. We have to use the thinking in a right way, guided by inner wisdom. That's what spirituality is about. How do I use the inner wisdom to give the direction to the thinking? That's where the thinking started, right? We have heard of IQ. EQ, SQ, IQ means intelligence, EQ means emotional quotient, and SQ means spiritual quotient. So a person who has a lot of intelligence will also have a lot of possibilities and impossibilities. Builds stress inside. So if he is emotionally stable, he will be able to handle it. If he is not emotionally stable, then a higher wisdom has to guide him. That is called spiritual quotient. The spiritual means deeper understanding of the truth has to go to your lower life. That's what spiritual wisdom. That's why as man grows older, he will become stressed. So the wisdom is required. Thinking is about learning, but are you learning the right thing or wrong way of thinking? Learning right way of thinking is called spirituality.
This is like a systemic thing. Like we have been growing up, want to explain that risk management is a business, risk consultancy is a business.
Absolutely.
So everything is like, you know, it's like
absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. No problems at all.
So everyone is conditioned to think about.
Risk management is important.
Insurance thrives on that.
Yeah.
Right? So, life is all about risks. But life is not about creating more risk for you by overthinking.
Yeah. No, but we've been conditioned because of these kind of
systems. So, the growing up process is nothing but conditioning by the society.
Yeah.
Okay, we are not looked at what is real.
Yeah.
So now, the spirituality is sit quietly and start understanding, is it real? So that's where we come to the question, what is real and what is non-real? Are you getting what I'm saying? Okay. Can you proceed further? Any more questions? Yes, sir.
So, looking for peace within is clearly established marriage.
Yes.
Do I have to just accept it at face value?
Yeah.
Follow it?
Yeah. So, is it a question or a statement?
The question is how it has been arrived at that for real peace you have to look within.
So, see, the question is getting peace is a direction which you have to move. Now the question is it conclusive? How it is arrived at? Is the question, right? So now, you don't have to ask anybody. You have to ask yourself, right? So these are all, life applies to me also. So whatever I do in life, why do I do it for, do it?
Why?
Maybe, anything you do in life, you become a...
For yourself.
Huh? For yourself. By doing something for yourself, what will happen to you?
Some fulfillment.
Some fulfillment, means some happiness.
Yeah.
Right? Then you don't stop it there, you go to something else.
Yeah.
Why?
Because fulfillment was not enough.
The fulfillment was not enough, disturbance started.
Yeah.
So fulfillment gave you peace momentarily, then disturbance started. Yeah. So then you started moving it.
Right.
So what are you looking for? Is there fulfillment you're looking for or work looking for? Peace if you're looking for peace?
Yeah, essentially peace.
Essentially peace.
Yeah.
So this is actually, the spirituality is not anything from the out of the world. So I saw met God and God told me this and all. No. Okay? Spirituality is about your life. If you look at your life closely, you'll understand what is reality. So only thing is a guide or a teacher can help you to prompt in the right thinking. Because our mind gets cluttered with so much of conditioning. So look here, what are you missing? So that's where the importance of Vedanta comes into our life. Okay? What is Vedanta? The Vedanta teaching is unlike any other spiritual teaching in the world. It's very, very different. So we say, all spiritual books are same, all spiritual teaching is same, everybody is politically correct statements we make. But politically correct is not necessarily correct in life. So Vedanta teaching is special in the sense that it only points out what you have already. Okay? It doesn't tell you something you'll get by doing this. What you have already, you don't have to do anything about it. You have to only understand it. So Vedanta prompts you to understand what you have, not prompting you to do something. Okay. Second thing is, Vedanta doesn't ask you to visualize something, imagine something. So there are very popular books, no, self-help books. What is self-help book typically? Day by day, I am getting better and better. Repeat 10 times a day. Okay.
Affirmations.
I am happy. This feeling is feeling miserable. No, you affirm. I am happy. I am happy. I am miserable. I am happy. So Vedanta is not an affirmation. Okay? Vedanta doesn't teach you about something to achieve. Vedanta is just uncovering what you have. Okay? And Vedanta is not a new belief system. You believe in this? No. Vedanta is not a belief system. Vedanta is not about believe in God, then you'll be happy. No. Vedanta is a immediate result. It is now and here. So if I promise you that after your death, you'll have peace. Right? So what is the typical WhatsApp message you send back after somebody here died? Rest in peace. For whom is the message? The person was disturbed when he was alive. And how can he rest in peace after he died? Of course, peace is there for the rest of the people. So I never understood for whom is the message? For the people who died, person who was alive. Person who was alive will be peaceful. Okay, Papa, this person has gone. So peace you have to find here and now. That is the teaching of Vedanta. Peace is not to be found elsewhere. Now, the peace which you find somewhere should not be conditional peace. So Vedanta doesn't put you hooks there. So if you, like typically in a loan document, no, bank loan document, 30 page document you have to sign, you don't know what you are signing. Vedanta is not about signing something which you don't know. No conditions attached. Unconditional peace. And that too, not by doing something, but by knowing something. This is the difference. So doing something and knowing something, there is a difference. There was a beggar who for 50 years he kept on earning money, begging. So he died. Then municipality people came. Then they thought it's not even worth taking this fellow to some other place and burying it. Let us bury very easily. And they started digging. They found a golden pot there. This fellow was sitting on crores of wealth right on top of it. That he didn't know. The difference is not having the wealth. The difference is knowing about wealth. Are you getting what I'm saying? Vedanta is not getting the peace. Vedanta is not working for peace. Vedanta is not a practice which will lead to peace. Vedanta is knowing the peace. Knowing the peace is having the peace. That's the difference between the Vedanta and any other system. Vedanta is not based on any belief system. But for us to make a big movement in Vedanta, we need to have a basic minimum belief. The basic minimum belief is the Vedantic teaching comes from a wise mind. Okay? Like you go to a doctor, only a trusted doctor. You can't go to a doctor, any doctor, especially if you have to perform get a surgery done. So Vedanta says, you have to find a trusted teacher. Teacher who can tell you, he can't mislead you. That's Guru. Vedanta says you need to have a trusted source of teaching. Even doctor should have some Grey's Anatomy or some standard textbook to teach. So Vedanta says the Vedantic teaching comes from the, what you call as, Upanishads. So which are trusted by Indians as a very authentic source of teaching. Many people have debated, questioned, fought over that and come to a conclusion. It has nothing to do with the, nothing but clarity and wisdom. So the text is authentic, the teacher is authentic, but he doesn't teach you something which you don't know. He uses your own life examples to teach you what you don't know, what you overlook. Your own life examples, your own lifestyle, your own thinking, he points out. And he points out the assumptions and beliefs which you are having, and he questions assumption and belief. A Vedantic teacher doesn't give you new beliefs. Vedantic teacher doesn't give you more Jnana, no more knowledge, already you are overburdened with knowledge. He doesn't give you answers. He questions you and makes you look at your life in a clear eyesight. So Vedanta is about questioning to understand life in a better way. That's where Vedanta is a dialogue between the student and disciple. And many times student asks the question, many times master asks the question, both of them arrive at a clarity and conclusion which is their own inner vision. And that's why Vedanta is called Upanishad.
Yeah. Just to see some longing. Longing for something. Whether it's like you want your son to reach IIT or you want to get a promotion.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
And then you're unhappy. Yeah. So longing is typically for a goal or for some longing for peace is
longing for something is always
is that good, bad?
Nothing wrong in that. See, Shri Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, dharma aviruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshava. That means the desire in human being is nothing but divine itself. Because desire keeps the world moving. Desire keeps the world going. If there is no desire, all social, secular and religious activities come to stand still. The world keeps going on based on the desire. Why the desire is there? I need something. That's perfectly alright. Okay? The desire per se doesn't create disturbance in you. The outcome of the desire comes to disturbance in you. Okay? So outcome, like I have a desire that I want to get a 99.99% marks in examination. Perfectly alright, work for it. Nothing wrong in that. It's dharma. But when you got 97 marks, you got disturbed. So desire is not problem. The importance you attach to the outcome is the problem. So 97 marks I got, okay, perfectly alright, 2 marks less. Something must have happened. Let me do something better. So then your life is moving into progress. But read the newspaper. After SLC examination, so many people commit suicide, 1 mark, 2 marks they commit suicide. What has happened to them? Okay. So desire per se is not problem. The type of desire is a problem. The desire per se is not a problem. How you fulfill the desire is a problem. Desire, how you fulfill the desire is not a problem. How much importance you attach to the outcome and how you take the outcome is a problem. A desire helps you to grow. Okay. So there's nothing wrong in that. But you have to be wise enough to have the right type of desire. You have to be wise enough to have the approach the desire in the right way. And you have to be able to, wisdom enough to handle the outcome of the desire in the right way.
So that wiseness is something that you build in your system, or is it, it's not like, it's not an English word.
No, the wisdom is, wisdom how to build in a system is the question. So, that's a very saying there in Kannada. Kelavam ballavarinda kalitu. You learn, sometimes people are wise enough to learn from others. Okay, some others did a mistake, I learned many times. Sometimes I learn by my own mistake. Sometimes I don't learn by my mistakes also. Right? So life is a sort of trial and error. By and large, because nobody has taught us to, taken us to a sort of, we go through a driving course now. Go through a driving course and then you'll get a license. Life has no driving course. Life is online. It's like live. So you do trial and error, learn. And some of the people fail in that learning and they become disheartened, disappointed. Some people succeed in life, succeed in what they get. Some people don't succeed, but still they have a wisdom in life. Now the wisdom can come through learning, or wisdom can come from the education, what you call spiritual education. Now spiritual education is bringing the wisdom of ancient wisdom, which is learned over 10,000 years of human history. In a way, you can apply it in your life. If you want to learn, learn from the wisdom, learn it. So that your learning curve becomes less. What are HR people doing? HR courses. HR courses are all about, okay, management skills. But why are you learning management skills? Because the management, something learning, you can, learning curve will come down. Like that, learning spiritual principles will bring down your learning curve in life and reduce the trial and error. Now, longing for spirituality, longing for peace is inbuilt in you. It's not a new thing. But the longing for peace you are trying to fulfill in wrong way or different way, which doesn't address the problem directly. The spirituality says longing for his peace is legitimate, address it right way. How? Asatoma sadgamaya tamasoma jyotirmaya. By addressing it, by wisdom, you address the peace. But are we struggling to have peace in different ways? Somebody wants to be peaceful, right? What did he do? He found a solution. He married a girl called Shanti. And that is the beginning of his learning in life, what is peace is not all about. Right? So we try to some roundabout way, a different means of finding peace. There's a direct way of finding peace. Be peaceful. Why struggle? By finding the peace, you, nothing that your work will not stop. You'll do it, but more peacefully. That's the spirituality. Okay?
So if it is about knowing only, mm-hmm. and not about any practices as mm-hmm. such, then is it not limiting the knowing at intellectual plane only,
no, no.
and not at experience?
So, see, here the question is a very right question. Spirituality is about knowing. Is it not an intellectual plane? So this knowing is very different from any other knowing. Okay? Vedantic learning is not about knowing which you do in the schools, in the colleges, in the education system, even in Vedanta class, it's nothing to do with that. So you read scripture number one, scripture number two, you understand, it's not about that. This knowing is questioning your deep-rooted belief systems about the self and looking at it and trying to understand this belief system is not in tune with the reality. So the knowing in spirituality is dropping what is causing problem. It is not stuffing with you more. So that's why it's an intellectual exercise, questioning what is wrong, questioning what is causing me a problem, dropping it, but it's not memorizing something. So once you drop it, then you start feeling relief. Okay? The spiritual teaching is not about learning more. It is unlearning more. Learning is a burden which you have acquired in life. Unlearning what is causing you stress is for spirituality. And that's where actually I want to use to be careful about the word spirituality. Typically it comes in the process called Jnana Yoga. See, you have yogas, different yogas, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Kriya Yoga, various yogas are there. Yoga means spiritual path. So Karma Yoga is related to action, Bhakti Yoga is related to devotion, Kriya Yoga is related to energy, Jnana Yoga is related to wisdom. So now, the moment I bring in yoga, that means action is involved. Okay? Karma Yoga involves service. Kriya Yoga involves energy practices, breathing practices, pranayama and all. Bhakti Yoga involves devotional practices. Okay? Jnana Yoga involves study of scriptures. What I am speaking is beyond four yogas. So these four yogas will help you mature in life. These yogas are important. But a stage will come, now you start questioning, what is still holding more peace for me? I have studied all the scriptures. I have done all the breathing practices a million times. I have done my chanting practices of some shlokas. Still, the promised land has not reached. The promise of peace is not there. I become peaceful. But in fact, I become my peace gets disturbed if I don't do the practice. It's the other way. Now I am addicted to the practice. So earlier you are peaceful, you didn't know. So somebody prescribed you 10 times you do breathing practice, you become peaceful. Okay, you started doing that. Then you find peace. Then one day you didn't do it, you disturbed. Your peace is dependent on the breathing. It becomes conditional peace. So this is what is called yoga. Now what I am telling you is beyond yoga. So that is called Atmavichara or self-enquiry. Atmavichara or self-enquiry is not learning something new. It is dropping something which is burdening you. Okay? So typically this Atmavichara, two pioneers are there. It's called, one is Sri Ramana Maharshi. he didn't have elaborate teaching. He just said, who are you? Okay. Then there's one person, one more master called Atmananda Krishnaman. He was in Kerala. So he administered a process of teaching by inquiring into reality, how you can know, discover yourself. So these are called direct path. So that's why in Bhagavad Gita it said, there are two paths. Loke asmin dvida nishta paraprokta mayanaga jnana yogena sankhyanam karma yogena yoginam. For most of the people follow the path of karma yoga. They want some action, right? So sit peacefully, I can't. I need to do something, do service. Sit peacefully, no, my mind is disturbed, do devotion. Sit peacefully, I am feeling dull, do energetic practices. So most of the people follow the path of karma yoga. So, but then a stage will come, you are matured in karma yoga, you have achieved what can best, you can get best out of it. Then you have to transcend it. Then opens up sankhya yoga. Sankhya yoga means, sankhya means a person who has become mature. For him, the self-inquiry is the way. There's no more learning. Now questioning what I have learned, something is missed out, get out of it. This is called Atma Vichara Yoga. So that is the final peak of spiritual journey. So, today is Sri Krishna Janmashtami, the greatest world teacher, Vishwaguru, who gave Bhagavad Gita to the world. Bhagavad Gita is the greatest scripture, spiritual teaching, absolute masterpiece. It is a summary of all spiritual practices available. It's like more of a sort of a different type of spiritual practices, what result they will give. Now you choose type of book. So today is Krishna Janmashtami. We will remember Shri Krishna, the wisdom of Bhagavad Gita. Shri Krishna said, Nasato Vidyate Bhavo, repeat, Nasato Vidyate Bhavo, Na Bhavo Vidyate Sataha. So the teaching of Shri Krishna in Bhagavad Gita is Nasato Vidyate Bhavo. What is unreal can never exist. Okay? What is real can never cease to exist. What is the meaning of this? If there is something reality in the world, there is something reality here and now, it doesn't cease to exist. It is somewhere here. I'm not looking at it, it's a different thing. If unreality is there, it will disappear. Okay, it can't stay long. So the truth or reality is right in front of us, right within us at this moment. The problem is our eyesight, our attention is somewhere else. Take your attention in the right direction, that inner bliss opens up. That is the teaching of Shri Krishna. So he doesn't even promise that you have to find the truth. You have to search for the truth. Okay? So here the Vedanta, the thing is, in yoga, journey of yoga, I said four yogas, karma yoga, bhakti yoga, kriya yoga, jnana yoga. It's about sadhana. Sadhana means achievement. It's an achievement only. Yoga is achievement only. Whereas Atma Vichara is shodhana, search oriented. There's a difference between sadhana and shodhana. What is the difference between sadhana and shodhana? Sadhana is practice. For example, I want to build a house. I don't have money. I need to work for 20 years to pay the EMI. I need to do sadhana to get a bigger house. Right? Shodhana is search. You have missed out, misplaced something, is find it. The Atma Vichara is about shodhana. Yoga is about sadhana. You have to understand the difference. So that's why the Vedanta teaching is, a lady is crying, saying that my necklace is lost. Okay? So then somebody says, what is there in your neck? Is it the same thing? Oh, yeah. Necklace was all the time in her neck. She was anxious in the hurry to go to marriage. She was anxious and thought the necklace is lost. So now, this is an example of Shodhana. No, I want to buy a necklace which cost me 1 lakh rupees. I have to work for 6 months to get it. That's called Sadhana. So after Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Kriya Yoga, Jnana Yoga, you come to Shodhana. It doesn't mean that these yogas are not required. They are required. They are a part of life, growing up. They lead to Chitta Shuddhi. But then you come to Atma Vichara, which is Shodhana, which is enquiry. To see what is there. Only thing is your attention has to be pointed to right thing. This is what is called spiritual. So, nasato vidyate bhavo, na bhavo vidyate sata. So, journey, here we are looking for seeing the reality, trying to understand the reality as it is. So, for that, our ancestors told there are three types of reality. These realities depend on where you stand. Our reality we call as Satyam. First is called Paramarthika Satya. Paramarthika Satya means absolute reality. Okay? Absolute means what? No conditions apply. It doesn't change with time, it doesn't change with space, it doesn't change with anything. It's called absolute reality. And that absolute reality they called as Brahman, which doesn't change at all. Okay? So any other reality depends on Brahman, that absolute reality. Anything depends on that absolute reality called Brahman. So that's called Paramarthika reality and that's called Satya. So when we speak Satya, it only refers to Brahman. The Satya, the word Satya has come into common language in Kannada and all languages. Satya hai lapan thera hai. We are telling about a fact. It's nothing to do with the fact. Fact is available to sense organs. Satya is about the supreme reality. So this is how the words get misused. Okay? So you start looking for, when you read spiritual text, you start Satya. Satya means, okay, I know I talk Satya. No. This Satya is absolute reality. Satya in Kannada language has changed me. Okay? So absolute reality is called Paramarthika Satya, which is unchanging with time. Then second level of reality comes, is called Pratibhasika Satya. Pratibhasika Satya means reflected reality. A reflected reality is your mental reality. It is done in the mind. Each of us have a worldview, right? We look at the world and respond to the world in different way. The same situation, two persons will respond in a different way. Why? Their mental models are different. For example, let us say, I mean, hoping that unless you are staying in a flat of some 20 floors, you open your door and see a beautiful, nice cow standing in the house in the morning, 6 o'clock. A white curl. How very divine cow. What do? You feed something, and probably some people do namaskar also. God has come. The same cow stands in front of somebody else's house. The person starts thinking of the food. The same cow a child sees milk. Same cow a businessman sees. Money. The objective reality is same, but subjective reality is very different. Right? So, like that, a situation, each of us have a subjective reality, which is very different from objective reality. That's called Vyavaharika Pratibhasika Satya or reflected reality. Why is it reflected? Because it's a reflection, it's not original. So in reflected reality, the subject and object are same, but I don't understand it. How? Hey, you told me like that. No, I didn't tell you. Where? No, physically, mentally discussion is going on. You are talking to yourself. The talker is you, the listener is you, responding to you. You are shouting at some person and he is responding back. A little man talking in your head. Does it happen to you? Huh? Conversation goes off. Then finally you conclude also, stupid fellow, and you come out. So reality is not there. The person is, talker is you, listener is you. Right? Have you seen this? You go to the bus stop. People in different worlds. Lost in the world. They're lost in the, not in the physical world, they're lost in the mental world. This is called Pratibhasika Satya. And third level is called Vyavaharika Satya. Vyavaharika means transactional reality. It's now you come to the physical world. Some give and take, the business, transactions happening. So mental reality can leave anything, but physical world you have to come to some transactions, right? Ultimately, you we might have shouted it to the friend in the mind, but ultimately you have to transact with them, interact with them. It's called transactional reality or Vyavaharika Satya. Are you getting clear, three clears? First is called Paramarthika Satya. Second is called Pratibhasika Satya. And third is called Vyavaharika. One is absolute reality, Paramarthika Satya. Absolute reality is not dependent on the mind and intellect. If it depends on mind and intellect, it's not absolute. It doesn't depend on my conception or your conception. It doesn't depend on time and place. That's called Paramarthika. Mental reality is different from you and you. All people are sitting here, but are they seeing same thing and hearing same thing? Each person his own mental world. Right? That's called Pratibhasika, because reflected. Then we have our transaction. Ultimately we have to transact. It's a physical level. So now why did I tell you these three realities? Because here is what we have to find. We are here to find the reality. Now out of these three realities, can you please give me which is number one for you? Number one, number two, number three. Paramarthika, Vyavaharika and Pratibhasika. Which is number one for you?
Vyavaharika.
Vyavaharika is number one. Okay, how many people what is it? Pratibhasika is number one. Mental learned reality. What about other people? All Paramarthika, absolute. What class, sir? Everybody is Paramarthika. Nobody is anything else.
I don't know. They actually ask for a tangible example which could be or absolute reality.
No, absolute reality will come to that.
So since I don't understand that, I can't even say if that's what I want.
No, number, let's take only between two and Paramarthika and Vyavaharika. Yeah. How many people are put Paramarthika and Pratibhasika and Vyavaharika?
Most.
Let us take a voting. Okay. So Vyavaharika reality is real compared to Pratibhasika reality. How many people vote? Okay. Pratibhasika reality is higher than the Vyavaharika. How many people? So now, Paramarthika is not there in picture because we don't know what it is. Right? Is that clear? So the whole spiritual teaching is, there's only one reality called Paramarthika. Other realities are not real. Other realities are only appearance. So now appearance has become real for you and reality has become non-existent. That's our situation. So that's why this discussion is about unreal to real. What you call as real, Vyavaharika and Pratibhasika, is unreal, whereas Paramarthika is the only reality which is there at the point of time. So this is important to understand how and why. Can you get me some water?
Let's
go. Thanks Shobha, she gave me water, but I asked for water and she gave me bottle. Why? No, it's okay. No chair, please. I asked for water and she gave me a bottle. Why? I asked for water and she gave me a bottle. Why? So when I say water, what I mean, the water is a word. The word indicates to an object, which is water, which is inside the bottle. That's why you give me the bottle. Right? So words are not reality. The meaning of the word is reality. Are you getting what I'm saying? But we live as if the words are reality. So that's why it's called pratipasika, reflective. We start taking the words as reality. In fact, the words is not reality. Meaning of the word is reality. Did you get the point? Okay, that's why Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to have, when a new student comes, okay, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to tell, what you have studied? What you have studied? Sir, I have studied so many scriptures before coming to you. I have mastered this scripture number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I am well read in all the scriptures. Okay. There is a scripture on my table. Can you look at that? He goes there. Sir, this is not a scripture. What is it? It's a book on rivers of India. Yeah, that's a scripture. There are 5 rivers in the Ganga, Yamuna, Godavari, Narmada, Sindhu river. I have mentioned in that book. Yes, sir, yes. Can you get me a glass of water from that book? No, sir, I can't get water from the book. Why? The books are words. Okay? Understand? The panditas or scholars of scripture are stuck in the words. So, at some point in spiritual journey, you have to leave the words and go to the essence of the words. That's your spiritual journey. Others, you are very proud. I have learned so many scriptures. You have learned words. Words are not reality. The meaning of the words is reality. Is that point clear to everybody? Right? So, water means the meaning of water, which is substance. Now, let us look at the meaning of a substance. Okay? Sir, what I am wearing? A kurta. Am I wearing a kurta, sir? Everybody agrees?
Yes,
sir. Is kurta a word or a meaning? Is kurta a word or a meaning?
Word.
Okay. Let us understand. Is kurta a word? Everybody agrees or disagrees? Anybody disagrees?
It's a word denoting
something. Word is giving a meaning. The meaning is something, but it's a word, is not a kurta. Okay? The word is only pointing to the meaning, which is something. That I agree.
Somebody else may call it as a shirt.
It's okay. I will understand kurta only. So do you agree that kurta is, the word kurta called kurta is not, is a, is not kurta, but it's pointing to kurta. The meaning of the word called kurta is pointing to kurta. Is it agreed? Ladies may object, okay? So we'll have a chudidar also. I'm not thinking only it's gender neutral, okay? So truth is gender neutral. So somebody says, I am wearing a chudidar, nice chudidar. The meaning of chudidar is not, chudidar is, the word is not chudidar, but meaning is some object. Is that clear? So now, this is kurta. Is this the object you are referring? The meaning of word called kurta, what is the object? This one, right? This is fabric. The real meaning of word kurta is called fabric. Okay, fabric appeared to be as kurta. So what is kurta? Are you getting the logic? Is, I am not supposed to go to the meaning, no? I should not get stuck with the words. Yeah, do you agree or not, madam? Do you want me to use chudidar?
No, you can wear kurta.
Kurta. So, the meaning of the word, kurta means a fabric. But is fabric kurta?
Shape.
So what?
Shape.
Oh, fabric has taken a shape called kurta. Right? The shape is also a word. It's a name and form. But real substance is what? The fabric. Are you getting what I'm saying? Otherwise, you are just using a word and saying kurta. So now you have to go to where? Fabric. But has fabric a kurta in it? Does fabric have a kurta?
Kurta has a
fabric. Kurta has a fabric. The fabric is the cause, kurta is the effect. Effect is the cause, but right? The cause has no effect. Are you getting what I'm saying? Fabric has no kurta, but kurta has the fabric. The logic is the other way. Clear? Agreed or not, sir? So, but kurta is never a shirt. Do you agree? That means shirt is made from non-shirt. The real meaning of shirt is not shirt. Are you getting logic? The real meaning of object called shirt, real substance of object called shirt, is not shirt. It's something else. So then what is the meaning of shirt? What is the word? It is a mere word. Shirt is a mere word, a pointer. Many software engineers are there, I think they are able to appreciate the logic, right? The word shirt is just a pointer to a substance, which is not a shirt, which is called fabric. Is fabric real, real word? It is made from the yarn, thread. So when I say shirt, I am referring to a substance called yarn, which is not a fabric, but which is not a shirt also. The real essence of shirt is yarn. Are we agreed? Logic is agreed? So the yarn is not shirt, the fabric is not shirt, but shirt is fabric, shirt is yarn. The other way logic is okay. Agreed? So shirt is made up of something called fabric, which is not a shirt. Fabric is made up of something which is called not fabric, called yarn, which is made up of something called cotton, which is not shirt, which is made up of something called atoms, molecules. None of them are shirt. Where is the shirt? So you, the moment you say shirt, we're living in mental reality. Shirt is this thing. The shirt is not this thing. Shirt is none of this actually. The essence of shirt is something else. The shirt is just a name and form. Everything in universe is transactional reality, which has nothing to do with reality. That finally when you come to that, is called absolute reality, paramarthic reality. Everything, essence of everything is called paramarthic reality. So how do we get to that, let's understand. The shirt is made up of fabric, which is not shirt. Fabric is made up of yarn, which is not fabric. Okay? Yarn is made up of cotton, which is not yarn. Cotton is made up of, I'll not go into more details, plant and all, atoms, which are not cotton. Okay? Atoms are made up of what? Subatomic particles, which are not atoms. Subatomic particles are made up of what? God knows. They call it God particle. Okay? So it's a concept. In the concept in the mind of scientists, there is some subatomic particle. So the concept is there where? Where is the concept? In consciousness. When you are naming, name is all coming to the mind. Now concept has gone beyond the mind. It's gone to intellect level. Now intellect, the consciousness is cognizing these concepts. So the essence of everything is consciousness. So what is the real substance, sir? Are you getting it on? Okay, let's take the flower. Is it heavy?
It will be heavy for the newcomers.
How many people are finding it heavy? We'll make it lighter with the flower. Who are the newcomers and finding it difficult to understand logic? Logic is difficult, what I'm giving?
Up to there it goes then.
No, we'll go beyond also, no problem. Up to this you forward now. I'll hold you and take you out beyond also, no way. So let us take the flower. What is this, sir? Agreed? Flower is a name. Name is not the flower. The meaning of the name is called flower. Do you agree? Okay. So now let me see. What is this flower made up of?
Petals.
now